Rally Four Weddings. Here, Rocky Four. Five.
Excuse me. I bought this video from you last Saturday.
So?
Well, I can't understand a word.
Plane spotting. Not surprised. All talking in Scotch, ain't they?
No. I mean, it's the sound.
Yeah.
It's hopeless. It's absolutely hopeless.
Yeah. No trains in it either. I suppose that's my fault as well. Here you are, darling. £4.99.
Well, the picture's rubbish as well.
Well, that's your tracking, mate.
Well, it's all right on my other videos.
Ooh, tracking's touchy.
Be careful. Most pirate videos are unwatchable, and there's no comeback.
Got a receipt, eh? Got a receipt?
Look, you said last week.
Said's no good, mate. Oral contract. Not worth the paper it's printed on. Here you are, darling, four weddings. Train spotting. As advertised on Crime Stoppers.
Pirate videos, daylight robbery.
To civilization. This is the way most of us have to live these days. The smell, the noise, the choking exhaust fumes, to say nothing of the frustration and the stress. There's got to be a better way. And this, I think, is it. Of course, most of us have to involve ourselves in the hustle and bustle of modern life because that's the way we earn our livings. But it's just about as far from our natural state as it's possible to be. So I believe that if we're going to cope with this modern madness, then we all need a safety valve. And gardens have served that purpose for centuries. The very first pleasure gardens as we know them were built in the Middle East, and they were seen as an escape from a hard and violent life and, of course, intolerable heat. They were looked on as a recreation of heaven on earth, and they called them paradisos, or paradises. They were used as places to get close to nature, to calm the nerves, to rejuvenate the spirit, and to refresh the body and soul. I believe that we all need that kind of therapy today. A quiet place, surrounded by the colour and perfume of flowers and disturbed only by the gentle hum of insects and the song of birds, where we can get away from the mad rush of civilization and back to our natural roots. Just like those ancient Persians, we all need our own private paradise. Ah, oh, Francesca, this is real high romance, isn't it?
It is, isn't it?
Wonderful. In this series, I'll be introducing you to people who have created gardens that are real havens of peace and contentment.
It's It's 15 foot wide, 12 foot at the narrowest, and 120 foot long.
So, that's yeah. going to be impossible yeah. to design. And I'll be showing you step by step how you can do the same thing in your own garden.
As I searched for those garden paradises, I realised that some of the best ones were created by people who didn't even have to try. I travelled to Oxfordshire, to a small village where I found a couple who seemed virtually untouched by modern life. Spending the day with Millie and Horace Hunt, I felt as if I'd stepped back into another world.
This is a lovely country garden, really. What's this bit up here?
Bit of a muddle, really. There's lots of flowers up there. The old Esther reeds and the...
Your wildflower section,
yes, that's right, yeah. Corn cockles and lots of feverfew and foxgloves. And I don't have to remember all the names, really.
Where do they come from?
They seed themselves, mostly. If you bring one plant in, they soon spread, don't they? Especially the Matricaria.
So what did you do? You bought a...
brought just
to
one or two plants. Well, actually, I saved the seeds of the corn cockle, and that's big, lovely big seeds. Yeah. Just spread it around, hoed it in a bit. It's good.
Super, isn't it?
Yeah, yes. Very good. This is Miss Wilmot's ghost. They get whiter and whiter as they get, as they develop, don't they? I
think they're lovely. That one's a pioneer, isn't it? Does that seed itself too?
Nearly every year. Yeah.
And look at the bees on it.
They're beautiful, aren't they? Yeah.
Absolutely covered in bees, beautiful. Yeah. What sort of work does this involve?
A lot, really, yes. Yeah. Such a lot of stuff to dispose of, either burn or compost or fill the old wheelie bin now. I was overwhelmed with weeding this year. I just thought at one stage I never would keep up. It was terrific.
You have to sort the plants out from the weeds, the seedlings out from the weeds.
Well, that's no problem.
How do you do that?
Well, I let it get big enough to be quite sure which is which. Mm. Not like Horace, have it weed free.
Because Horace goes around with his hoe, doesn't he?
But then he would hoe up a lot of things here that I would want to leave. I know I had an operation, I broke my arm, and I looked out of the bedroom window and I said, what are you doing on there? You don't pull that up. Poor Horace sort of shrank back.
You do the flower garden and Horace the vegetable garden.
Definitely his and hers, really.
You're growing some mighty good crops in here, I must say. You obviously eat a lot of red currants because this bush down here is loaded, isn't it?
No, I don't eat them myself, but...
You don't eat them? So what do you do with a crop like this?
Pick them and sell them.
You sell them, do you?
I picked £70 of currants in one day off of there to get the order.
Did you? Yeah. So the money you make from that, does that help to pay for your garden?
Yes. A pound or two is always handy somewhere in there.
Absolutely, yeah. Quite a crop of gooseberries, too.
Yes, they've done fairly well.
Do you always get a good crop like that off your gooseberries?
So far,
what do you do with those?
I'll sell them to anyone who wants them.
Well, I saw...
I've made wine with them before now.
Oh, do you? Yeah. You obviously eat some as well, because I saw Millie topping and turning some.
Well, I'm not sure, but they're a bit acid for me.
Tell me, Horace, where did you learn your gardening?
Well, from your parents,
on the allotment, really,
whatnot,
I suppose. They all grew vegetables and allotments.
As soon as
you
could pick a tool up, really, and you know, you'd go help do things in those days. There was no dole or anything. You'd got to get some means. If you couldn't get work and money, you'd got to try and help yourself grow something.
You starved.
So, Millie, how long have you lived here?
I was born next door and we moved here when I was about 10. Is that right? I think that was right, wasn't it?
1977, when you moved into here.
So I was 70, so I've been here 70 years.
So you've always actually lived within 50 yards of here? Mm. Yeah.
It used to be agricultural, of course.
There are still farms, but more on the outskirts. They used to be right in the village, didn't they? I mean, cows and pigs, you know, just... I used to drive cows all up the village street, right from here up over the bridge, into the little meadow up there, we used to call it. Whistler's Meadow then, wasn't it?
And who lives here now?
Pardon?
Who lives here now?
Oh, well, quite wealthy people, some of them, I suppose.
The Nobs.
But I know then, this has been recorded.
Well, you live in a wonderful place here, and you lead a very quiet and very simple life. But do you class yourself as rich?
Rich? I've never earned £30 a week in my life.
Is that so?
So where can I get rich? Off the pension?
I think we've got all we want, though, really. We've decided we're going to stay and hope we'll die in the garden. I do anyway, I don't know about Horace.
I nearly made my mind up to be buried up that piece of garden there.
Under the walnut tree, amongst the roots. We thought that should be fairly sort of safe. And...
So, Millie, do you look upon this as your own little earthly paradise?
Yes, it's got to be, hasn't it? I think so, yes. I know every inch of it now after all these years. All my own work, really. Well, bar what Horace has done, he does the topiary and helps look after the fish pond. He did build that, by the way. But, yeah.
Well, I have to tell you, Millie, that while I've been sitting here talking to you, you haven't stopped smiling.
Well, why not? There's no reason why I shouldn't smile, is there? I'm very happy life, I think. I think a lot of people would like to take my place, actually.
I think you're right. If you live in a big city where people are inevitably crammed together, then you really just have to accept the fact of a community existence. OK, once you've shut your front door, then you've got your castle and that is your privacy. But then as soon as you step out into your back garden, of course, your neighbours must be on top of you. So I've come to the city of Cardiff to see how Felicity Norton copes. As you walk in here, I mean, you probably wouldn't notice it anymore, but to me, it's a perfect country garden.
Mm. Oh, thank you. Yeah. I tried.
Absolutely lovely. Yeah. And it's filled with colour and perfume. Yeah. Really nice.
Yeah, see the roses.
It's a very funny shape, though, isn't it? I mean, what are the dimensions of the garden?
It's 15 foot wide, 12 foot at the narrowest, and 120 foot long.
That's got to be impossible to design, isn't it?
It is. Well, I've kept the pads down to as narrow as possible to get as many plants in, you know.
Even so, you've got all sorts of little features.
This is how I made a little sort of sitting area in a pond.
Yeah. That's lovely.
So you've got to have water in a garden.
Absolutely.
From the frogs and everything.
The thing that really gets me here is that you're right in the middle of the city, but it's so quiet, isn't it?
Yes. Well, like, we seem to be buffered a bit, you know, because we've got the mature tree and the hedges and we've got Maureen's house there, you know, it's sort of absorbing the sound, which is quite nice.
So plants really can do that?
Of course they do, yes, they create breaks, don't they, you know, and they do. Yeah, I like to come and go in the garden and not be seen, like we all do. So I've planted, like, herbaceous things. They come up in the summer when we're mainly, say, using this area. And Maureen doesn't mind too much, and then they sort of die down. Nothing too permanent.
But I suppose from the top windows, the neighbours can still see you.
Oh, yes,
so
yes.
You've got all sorts of little hideaways.
Oh, yeah. I wanted you sort of walk 6 foot and then never sit down. I've made different areas. It's like I've got, like, where I've got my fern collection, and that's very shady because the garden is sort of south facing and the sun's in the back, luckily, practically all day. And then you come out of there, up onto the brick path, and you turn left, and you've got sort of, I tried for a Mediterranean hot area with a shady seat at the back. If I want to cook, you know, I sit there.
I tell you what, Felicity, I could stay here all day.
Come on then. And then up the corridor, about halfway along, another bench put in again with the clematis going over. The 12 violet, I think. And that's quite nice to sit in, and again, you've got a different perspective. And then at the end, I made shady retreat area with a golden hop, because it's nice when you're down by the ferns, you can look right up the garden, you just see this gold arch thing. But I put mirrors at the back, so it looks like the garden goes on and on and on.
That's rather clever, isn't it? The garden's absolutely filled with perfume too. It's great in the city, isn't it? You know, not a whiff of carbon monoxide here, or carbon dioxide.
No, not what I wanted, because first thing in the morning, come out, breakfast, cup of tea, sit there, getting ready for the day, and you've got, you know, the honeysuckle, the jasmine, and I can come home to it as well. It's lovely with a full moon. You get the lovely sort of harvest moons, and you sit there, and all goes quiet. Everybody's in watching telly. Well, be a bit naff and say it's food for the soul. Really, it's so hectic, you know, day-to-day grind, and you come out and you sit somewhere beautiful, and that's what it's all about, isn't it? You know, I get all soppy. But it is, I think, oh yes, food for the soul, when you feel regenerated and rejuvenated, you know, by it. It's better than Valium. It's soothing, it's tranquil, it's That thing where you switch off. Like, some people sort of come home and have a gin and tonic or something to switch off. Well, I can come and sit in my garden and it's just off.
For many of us, the chance to lose ourselves in our gardens is the perfect antidote to the pressures of modern urban living. But as I found out, even an Anglican friar like Brother Vincent still needs his garden.
Well, Brother Vincent, you have, apart from the odd aeroplane or two, a wonderfully quiet, secluded garden here. How long have you been gardening it?
I've been gardening here over the last 5 years, quite consistently, but prior to that, I made a start a little over 12 years ago in clearing the stinging nettles and revealing many of the trees and shrubs that had been planted at the end of the 50s and early 60s.
Well, it rather looks as though you're in the position of nature continually trying to grab back what you've
taken. That's right, indeed.
But here and there, I mean, you've got wild plants coming through here, like the buttercups and the campion, etc., which I think actually add to the garden
don't they? Yes.
And looking around, it strikes me that you're a bit of a rhododendron and azalea enthusiast.
That's right, indeed.
Yes. I think rhododendrons, magnolias, camellias would be my major love. But I think I'm aware of the variety of colour here, particularly the greens here, different shades of green, but also the smell, perfume that one would come from azaleas and from other plants.
Let me ask you a cheeky question. All around us there are beautiful plants, including lots of wildflowers, which God has brought to you. But God has also brought you the nettles and the rest of the weeds. How do you feel about that?
Well, I'm certainly happy in a way for them to be around here. Otherwise, it would be very formal and perhaps in a sense without one level much life. But the stinging nettles, campion and other wild plants around just add, I think, and give some body, as it were, to the garden.
Now, you're quite a busy person here. What else do you do apart from the garden?
I'm also the community's tailor. I've worked for many years, originally with a team of four brothers. There were five of us originally in the tailor shop here. So I combine tailoring with developing the garden here. Mm.
Do you feel you get enough time in the garden?
There are times I think where I'd like to spend more time here, yes. But I obviously have to balance that. It wouldn't be right to spend all the time here, otherwise we should be going around in patched habits.
Now, occasionally you have quiet days. And what actually is a quiet day?
Quiet day would be when there would be just two brothers who would be responsible for looking after the friary, responsible for the meals, answering the telephone, dealing with the postman. That allows
Oh, what a wonderful old house, isn't it?
Isn't it lovely?
Lovely.
Yeah, wonderful courtyard.
And how old will it be?
Well, the house in its present state is really late medieval. And it was owned by the Vaughan family.
Well, that's about 15th century.
Yes, that's right, yeah. And Sir Roger Vaughan, who lived here in the late 1400s, really built and developed the house. Mm.
But this is his garden. It's a very beautiful...
Right, yes.
And this is a genuine sort of medieval reconstruction, is it?
No, it's a recreation, because there wasn't a garden here to begin with, and in fact no medieval gardens survive at all.
Oh, why were structures like these so important to medieval people?
Well, an arbour like this was meant to create a green shade so that all the highly born medieval ladies could walk up and down and enjoy the flowers and the open air, but remain pale, not be touched by the rays of the sun.
Why was it so important to stay pale?
Well, it was to show your status and your wealth, because it showed that you didn't have to go outdoors and toil.
As you walk through the tunnel, you're absolutely surrounded by perfume, aren't you?
Yes.
Which must have been quite important in medieval times, because there were some pretty nasty smells around, weren't there?
Well, there certainly were, yes. I mean, they were very smelly and unhygienic times. And so anything perfumed is really much prized. People lived more communally in those days, so there was less privacy, even for the great ones of the medieval time. And I think the chance to just wander away from other people was probably much appreciated.
There are lots of old prints which seem to suggest that these gardens were used for things like love, for example.
Oh, gosh, yes. Well, courtly love was a wonderful system of manners and behaviour that was developed to make the wild fighting barons and noblemen behave themselves a bit when they came home from fighting. And it was to do really with being a bit restrained and civilised, and doing things with your brain rather than with your sword arm. And you had to have a great lady of the house, and she would have a suitor or suitors. They weren't her husband, but they were her suitors. And a place like this was a place for courtly love. Now over here we have a turf seat, a little turf place to sit with daisies growing up and the roses behind. And this is the place for courtly love. And to explain it properly, Jeff, I really need you to play a suitor. And if you can imagine it, me to play a medieval lady. So will you come over with me? And he would be in a frenzy of anticipation. So I'd quite like you to look a bit more frenzied, if that's
possible.
I'm doing
my best.
And when they met, he would have to offer her something that he'd done with his brain. So he would read to her a poem, perhaps, or something that he could actually read, or show her a piece of writing. He might even sing to her and offer that to her as a symbol of his pure love. But he would have to do it, I think, for the sake of historical accuracy, on one knee. Would you mind?
You want
would
me
you
to
mind?
Do this, don't
would you?
I can see. Well, prithee, fair maid,
yes,
give
indeed.
Me your heart.
Indeed. Now, offer me something that you've done with your brain, Jeff.
Oh, my God. And did the ordinary chap have his little garden as well?
He probably had a little garden to grow things in. But a pleasure garden like this one was really only for the most wealthy. It was a real status symbol to show that you could have a little piece of ground that didn't need to be cultivated and where plants were grown just because they were beautiful, not for any particular reason. The medieval world was often very confusing and anarchic and strange. Although it was a time of very strict rules that governed who you were, even what you wore and what you ate was governed. But the reality of medieval life, I think, was often more chaotic than that. And so an enclosed garden where nature was trained and where you felt safe and secure was probably much appreciated.
I believe that we all need that kind of therapy today. Now, it may be that you live in the city, walled in by bricks, concrete and tarmac. Or perhaps on a crowded housing estate, overlooked on all sides by your neighbours. Even in the country, you may be plagued by the noise of traffic or aeroplanes. So it would be understandable if you felt that paradise was impossible to achieve. But believe me, it isn't. So next week, I'm going to start to show how to make real havens of peace and contentment in your own garden. If I was asked to describe my idea of heaven on earth, it would certainly be set in a country garden like this, surrounded by a glorious jumble of colour and perfume, and shared with those most beneficent of creatures, the birds, the bees, and the butterflies. Well, I believe that it is possible for all of us, here and now, and whether you live in the town or the country, to create that perfect paradise. But of course, the first things that you need are those most precious of commodities: peace, quiet, and privacy. Now, you may feel that's impossible to achieve, but believe me, it isn't. However crowded and noisy your surroundings may be, we can all use our gardens to hide ourselves away and immerse ourselves in the natural world.
Started with Ellie, got some seed and planted them up, and they grew up. So we decided to get some more, and they grew. And then we bought a planter, a box, you know, and then another one, and then another one. And it just wound up like that, you know, it's just got from bigger to big.
We're 30 feet up in the air now, we're on the roof, and there was no garden when I bought the house, and so I had to invent a garden. And the only way to do it was with pots and filling spaces with as much colour and as much greenery as I could. I started off in rather a small way here with a few pots, and then it grew and it grew, and now we've got over 1,000 pots, and it was really just an experiment to see what would grow in pots, what you could do. And now it's all taken over.
At Barnsdale, I will design and build two gardens, one that costs a fair bit and the other designed with economy in mind. They will both be specifically made to create a rural environment wherever they're situated, and they're both based on the original Persian paradise gardens. The ancient Persians built their gardens to appeal to all the senses. I will use highly scented plants to create a wonderful treat for the eye and the nose. I have designed the gardens to be restful, so sitting areas are important. The town garden has a sitting area facing a large pond. In the budget garden, there'll be a shady arbour to sit and look out on a small wildflower meadow. A tunnel to walk through before sitting again on a patio that will cost virtually nothing. Before starting the groundwork on my two gardens, I set out to find gardeners that had already created beautiful country havens that were situated in the most difficult city locations.
Martin, you live in one of the busiest cities in the world, and yet you've created around your house what is really a leafy countryside haven. Now, why have you done it?
I did it, I suppose, because I live in London. I don't have a normal garden. I was brought up in the country, and I want to create as rural an environment as I can to live in. I love the countryside, I love the open air. I like to spend as much time as I can out of doors. And with this roof garden, I somehow have managed to create an environment that is unexpected. It gives me huge pleasure. I come back at the end of the day and walk and water and think and enjoy it. Gardens are there to be enjoyed, I think.
Now, you're overlooked on all sides. In London, you can hardly avoid that. You've got a school down below there, which makes a little bit of noise. You're giving your neighbours a wonderful view, but how do you achieve your own privacy?
I suppose by building screens like we have here, trellis with things tumbling through them, which doesn't really block out anything, but it's just the idea that you are protected from prying eyes. Not that I mind. There are nice people there and they look down in the garden.
Now, Martin, because your garden is 30 feet up in the air, everything has to be in pots. Is that not very time-consuming?
Well, it is, but it gives one remarkable flexibility. The pots have to be maintained, and the beginning of the year, there's hectic activity up here, planting out things. But at this time of the year, it becomes more maintenance, tidying up, and just constant watering. And I think watering is my favourite part of it.
You seem to be very fond of blue campanula.
It seems to be very fond of us. People have called it the Chelsea weed because it now proliferates everywhere. And it's self-seeded. So at this time of the year, it's got this wonderful sort of light mauve purple. And I just let it go wherever it wants to and use that as a background colour to add purples and crimsons and pinks and things. If it likes it here, I'm not going to say no.
And obviously, the plants like you. You enjoy your container garden, don't you?
Oh, yes. I think plants reflect the attention you give them. If you look after them, they respond. If you don't, they sulk. unlike some people who, if you're nice to them, still sulk.
Well, your plants certainly aren't sulking.
You have a massive planting here. Do you ever get any wildlife?
Oh, yes. I mean, a lot of birds. Magpies and jays and robins and wrens.
Even in London. I can hear a tremendous amount of bird life now.
Well, yes, you can, because I have tapes of birds. I had the dawn chorus recorded in Northamptonshire, and I like to play them through the minaret speakers, which encourages other birds to come and sing.
Oh, does it really?
Yes. I've had extraordinary times where a song thrush will imitate the bird on the tape and create a dialogue.
So all that I can hear is really a bit of an illusion, is it? How do you control it?
Well, I can turn the volume up. Or I can turn it off.
Do you ever play other things through there?
Oh, yes, I like to play the sound of cicadas, you know, the zzz, zzz. And that creates a feeling that it's warm and you're in a Mediterranean environment. It's a very nice background sound, particularly on a cold day.
And how do the neighbours react to this?
Sometimes they ring me up and say, can I put the birds on, because they've got a dinner party outside.
If you look at the plan, you'll see there's a fair area of paving. And paving, quite frankly, is expensive and way beyond our budget. So, to solve the problem, I borrowed a trailer and I went down to the reclaim yard. And sure enough, there in a corner was a great pile of old rubbish, which I bought from him for next to nothing. A few old paving slabs, some roofing tiles, some crazy paving, bricks, cobbles, and even a sewage pipe or two. They'll all come in useful. Now, if you're going to save money by paving with all sorts of odds and ends, there is, I'm afraid, a price to pay. It's just a little bit more fiddly. Now, you start off by banging in pegs all over the area that will finish at the level you want the paving to finish at, and you level those in with your straight edge and spirit level to make sure, if you're paving up against the house, that the paving slopes very slightly away from the house. And then you dig out below the pegs and put in the base. Now, the base consists of 6 parts of ballast to 1 part of cement, and you mix it dry and just rake it out level and then tread it down with your feet nice and hard, and the water will come up from the bottom, the rain will come down from the top, and it will very soon harden up. But you must make sure that you leave plenty of space between the top of the peg and the base, because bear in mind, all these materials you're using are different thicknesses. Now, you may remember from the plan that in this little corner I'm going to have a utility area for things like dustbins. So I want to hide those with a bit of trellis and hence these posts. But of course you must put the posts in first, otherwise you'll be disturbing the paving. The paving slabs are laid on 5 points of mortar. You need quite a bit of mortar, believe me. But I can promise you that what you've gained on the swings by buying your stuff cheaply, you're not going to lose on the roundabouts. And you just rest the slab on the top like that, and then just tap it down level with a handle of a club hammer. But you must keep checking all the time that it's absolutely right with your straight edge, and that's fine. Now, normally when you lay slabs, you would butt them up close together, but on my patio, I'm leaving this little space in between, and I'll explain why later. Now, when you lay bricks, you can see why you need a bit more space below it, because they go on their sides. Another one in there, I think that'll look rather nice. These sewage pipes can be quite easily cut with an angle grinder, which you can hire quite cheaply, and they come in for all sorts of uses. I've set this one onto mortar, but once the mortar's gone off, I shall knock out the middle bit and then put some soil in and use it for planting. But I've got another quite interesting use for the sewage pipes. It may seem a bit odd to use roofing tiles as a paving material, but in actual fact, laid on their edge, they make a very attractive and a very durable paving. Now, while I had the angle grinder to hand, I just cut them in half, because obviously that makes them go twice as far. And then they're simply pushed into a bed of mortar. You just make sure that they're reasonably level, although they are very good for changing levels as well, if you want to put them on a bit of a slope, and I think that'll look very nice. Leave the paving to set really hard for a few days, and then you can start work on the planting pockets. The first job is to knock out the concrete from the bottom and get rid of that, and then fill up the hole with a bit of really gritty compost. Now, this should consist of equal parts of soil, coarse grit and garden compost, and then you can plant into that a spreading alpine like this little perennial lobelia. Instead of pointing in between the slabs and the bricks with sand and cement, you do it with a bit of compost, the same compost that was used for planting the plants. And that means you can have plants right the way over the patio. When you've completely filled all the cracks with compost, it's a good idea to put a bit of water on the top, and you'll find that this will wash quite a lot of compost between the cracks, and you'll have to do it again. You might even have to do it two or three times to really fill it up. And then what I want to do is to sow between all those cracks with alpine plants, which will grow quite happily in between the paving. So what you do is to get some mixed alpine seeds and just put them in a bucket full of sharp sand and mix it round really thoroughly, like that. And then that can go on the paving and just brush it in around the cracks. Now, you will find, of course, that if you tread all over the alpines, then obviously they're going to die out. But that doesn't really matter, because what'll happen is that they'll die out on the bits of the patio that are really well used, but on the rest of it, they'll thrive, and you'll have a really attractive looking patio.
Five, I think I was, and it was in the school holidays, and I went to McDonald's and bought a meal, and I got some seeds free with it. I just planted them, and I went out there with a watering can that I got free with these seeds, and I had a shovel that I dug it with, and I just watered them every night, and they just come off, and Mum and Dad thought it was a really good idea.
I mean, it wasn't planned at all. We had no intent. Well, when we first moved here, we was the same as everybody else. We just had a plain balcony that if it was hot, you went and stood out, you looked out, and there was traffic.
We've always been brought up in flats.
I've lived in these flats since I've been born, so I've never known no different. My mum and dad never had window boxes or anything. It's just a plain balcony. So I think we've achieved something quite good.
Just making the best of a bad thing, isn't it, really? Well, not such a bad thing, just, you know.
Best of what we've got.
You just go to work, then you come home, and, well, it's our breath of fresh air. My breath of fresh air, anyway. It's like, you can go out of an evening, providing you can switch off the noise of the traffic, you could be anywhere. In the middle of the country, or a nice little garden somewhere in the country, because you've got all the same plants as you would have in a garden, just limited for the amount of space. But if you can switch off where you are, we both have a go together. It's you know, she's the one that knows the plants, but I know these osters. I like the osters. They're a bit of class, I think, an oster. You ever look at one of them? All the petunias and everything else is just like normal bedding stuff, really, just put it in every year. But we've got some cordylines that are doing quite well out there. There's quite a few of them out there now. We're lucky, really, because we're facing the right way for the sun, like the south. And most things we put out there do grow. Hence the watering system, part of it. The reason we put it out there is because you get soaking wet, watering everything. You can't swing a cat out there. It's, you know, there's no room at all. If you do the front's dripping. Then you're so mad to do the back, and all the front drips on your back, so you're soaked and you've got to get in the bath. So this way, it's like little drip heads and little sprays that go around. And they're all different sized drip heads according to how much water you want going to each plant. Like the bigger the pot, the more water you want going to it. You just turn it on and boom, and it waters itself, like, you know. Just walk away and give it, say, 10 minutes, quarter of an hour. Turn it off and you're done.
Once you start putting a few plants out there, it's surprising how it does change your life. You forget what's going on underneath and on, in the road, and you forget that there's traffic building up. It's lovely.
All right, you don't have to go over the top like we have. Just a couple of planters, just a couple of flower boxes, that's all you need. Don't cut a fortune. Make the world a better place, wouldn't it? Just a bit of colour here and there. Barren block of flats and also just a big mass of colour as you come along.
The Gardiner family certainly proved that anything is possible. Who knows, one day Bermondsey in South London may be filled with the colour and scent of flowers. As I emerged out of yet another traffic jam and ventured on my way back to Barnsdale through yet another fume-filled road tunnel, I remembered all the sweet-smelling tunnels I've visited and realised once again why gardening and Barnsdale has kept me so content.
From
my tunnel, I want to use hazel because it'll give me some very pleasant shade in the summer. And in the autumn, if I can keep the squirrels away, of course, hazelnuts as well. But I want to make the tunnel as uniform as I possibly can. So I'm going to start off by making a sort of a training arch with cut hazel. And to make that uniform, I've banged some stakes in the ground here to make a template. And then what you do is to stick your bit of hazel around the pegs like that and just bend it around carefully. Now, the fresher you can get this, the easier it bends. So try and buy it freshly cut. It goes in there. The other one goes the other side in just the same way. That's bent round too, carefully. Carefully twisted round the pegs too, like that, and then they can be wired together. Once you've made these arches, of course, you can't bang them in. So I have banged in these short posts at each station just to make sure that the arch is firm, make sure that they're nice and solid, and each leg goes down by the side of the post. And that'll be fixed to it later on. Now, the only way, really, of working out whether it's level or not is to do it by eye. This side, I think, needs to go down a bit. Now, the arches are nailed to these posts, but do bear in mind that hazel is popular with furniture makers and fencing makers and thatchers because it will split easily. And that's the last thing we want at the moment, so it has to be drilled. The final job is to fix horizontal hazel rods, one at the top and two on either side. And these are fixed in the normal way, just by wiring them on. And once again, you will have to continually stand back and just eye them up to make sure that the rods are horizontal and that the frames are in the right shape. And then this will turn those rather wonky arches into a very respectable tunnel. But do bear in mind that this is really only a training frame for the real thing. Now, you can buy one-year-old nut trees from specialist nurseries, but you'll certainly have to search them out. And do remember that if you want a crop of nuts, then you do need two varieties, one to pollinate the other. I've bought a variety called Ennis and one called Gunslibert, so I certainly should get some good crops from those. The trees are planted in prepared soil in the normal way, planting them at the same level they grew in the pots. And it's a good idea to use the same variety either side of the arch for a much more uniform effect. And then it only remains to tie the plants into the archways. Along the bottom of the nut walk, I've decided to plant a couple of rows of lady's mantle. These superb evergreens are quite easy to grow in sun or shade, and in the summer they'll produce a foam of greeny yellow flowers. And I love the way the leaves trap the shining dewdrops.
My mission to bring the countryside into the garden wherever we live is now fully underway. The next problem to solve is how to create privacy without causing a feeling of claustrophobia. This can be helped by creating secret corners using features in the garden. So next week, I'll introduce you to more experts who have already succeeded. And I'll show you how to do it yourself with plants, shrubs and trees.
If you think of your own personal idea of an earthly paradise, I'm sure that most of us would have visions of green rolling hills, shady trees and flower-studded meadows, all orchestrated by the song of birds and the buzzing of insects. In other words, the countryside. But in reality, few of us have the good fortune to live in such an Arcadian situation. But you know, even if you live in the town, in a small garden like this, surrounded by high brick walls, by using plants, you can still soften those man-made features and surround yourself with a little bit of the natural world. I think this little garden proves the point. But when we started, it wasn't exactly like this. When we first came, it felt like being in Alcatraz, with an 11-foot wall at the back and 6-foot walls at the sides, there was a desperate feeling of enclosure. It's like that, of course, with many town gardens, and one of our first jobs was to get rid of it. Now, you live right in the centre of town, Jeff, and your garden is overlooked on all sides, really, so it could be quite a public place. And yet, when you come in here, you get a great feeling of peace and tranquility. And privacy. Now, how have you managed that?
Well, I suppose this was the most public wall. I mean, there's a public garden there, really, that belonged to the pub. And also, there used to be sort of quite a view here of the backs of those buildings. And so I built these brick piers and put this double rail, pergola rail, along the top here. And since then, it's been clothed with various climbers.
So by hiding the view with plants, you've actually cut off the view from outside and yet without making it look oppressive.
Yes, yeah. That's right. Yeah. That's right.
They've also created in the garden a series of little private secret corners. Is that for privacy too?
Yes, I think this has developed over the years, really. One's seen the potential of one particular spot. And for example, when we came here, that wall divided the two gardens completely. I could easily have taken down that wall and made it just one single garden, but it seemed to have more three-dimensional sort of possibilities if one simply made an arch in the wall there and had another way through at that end. It gave one a sort of circulation, and it gave me the opportunity of having a north-facing wall as well as a south-facing wall, which was a great advantage, really, because landing on this side is just as interesting as the landing on the sunny side.
Now, you've also used trees quite a bit to create privacy as well.
Yes. Well, the whole of that boundary was planted, really, to screen that quite large wall. And so the important thing was to get fairly sort of fast-growing, fairly sort of heavy planting in front of it. And so most of that planting on that side is not really to do with privacy, but to do with concealing that sort of heavy boundary. But really, garden design is about creating spaces with a sort of particular character. And I think the planting inside and the space has to have a sort of balance.
Another way to reduce the claustrophobic effect of the walls is to make the garden look bigger by stealing your neighbour's trees. Well, you just borrow them, really. Now, outside my garden, I've got a couple of big acers here. And what I want to do is to plant another smaller one my side of the wall to make it look like a natural group of three plants.
Now, that way, the wall will disappear, the garden will look very much bigger, and it'll also hide that ghastly electricity substation. Now, you can, of course, buy small trees and wait for them to grow, but for this particular job, I'm impatient, so I've been down to the garden centre where they stock some pretty big trees. Now, they have the one great disadvantage, of course, that they are expensive, so the preparation and planting has to be really thorough. Now, this consists of 50-50 coarse grit and fine bark. And to that, I've added a bit of organic fertiliser just to give the tree a start. And then with a tree of this size, you're going to need the help of a willing next-door neighbour to plant it. Fine. OK, thanks very much. I can manage now, I think. Now, with big trees, it's absolutely essential to stake them really well. And what you could do with this one is to put up three guy ropes all round, but they do look a little bit conspicuous. So I've developed this contraption to actually hold the root ball down. And it just consists of four bits of wood screwed together. Of course, there's a very solid root ball underneath here, so these pieces of wood will more or less sit on the top of that. So if I can hold that firm in the ground, the tree isn't going to move. I can then hammer in a peg on each one of these, and that'll hold it pretty firm. Yeah, that should hold it nice and firm. And of course, once the wood's covered with soil, you won't see it at all. This is a medium-sized shrub, Acer palmatum. And once the leaves come on them, all these three are going to look terrific.
Both my gardens at Barnsdale are almost square, but many town gardens are long, narrow and straight. With these, careful design is even more important. I remembered my old friend Anne Dexter in Oxford. She solved her major problem of neighbours overlooking her garden on all sides by building upwards in gradual layers.
I've always loved gardening, and so has my mother. My grandmother especially, she had a huge garden up in Cumberland. And when I came here, I turned the house around to have the sitting room looking out down the so-called garden as it was then. And there was a huge tree in the middle of the lawn, which I had removed. And then I took the top off the lawn and had, oh, I don't know how many square yards of crazy paving brought and dumped. I did the paths on my own. I had it brought through the house, but it was dumped here, and I did it because there was nothing. Luckily, there are a few houses that have walls, and luckily I was one of the ones that had a wall. So I sort of went off from the wall and had a wriggling path going down to the bottom, so that you didn't ever, hopefully didn't see everything at once. And then having done the paths and laid out this bit on this sitting place, I dug out what I'd laid down in the middle so I could have dry stone walls, because I wanted to grow up at small alpines and things like that, and I couldn't have done that in amongst the thugs at the back. Down at the bottom, where it's quite a different atmosphere. I've got all my trilliums and fritillaries, Ramondas and abelias. And that is, I dug that out and made the walls for these plants. And it was really just a shade-loving plant area. So there's that area, and then there's the middle one, and then there's one near the house. You can get a variety of different plants and shrubs. And then I suppose from about 3 foot high, all the shrubs that you see now, which are going up to the sky, were very small. But over the years, you don't notice it, they just grow and grow. And then it just happened, I suppose, that all the things that I bought, the shrubs and things, which were only about 3 to 4 foot high when I bought them, grew and grew and grew, and it got sort of more and more enclosed. And I can grow far more things when they're growing upwards than I could if, you know, it was all sort of a level. By growing plants that were tall, and then shrubs that were tall, and pruning them, and then I just go up and up and up. I suppose there are about 4 layers, so that I've got all sorts of different shapes and heights in the garden.
Well, the first thing that Anne did when she got into her garden was to increase the height of the fence with a bit of trellis. And if your fence is a bit low, you can do the same thing quite easily. You're unlikely to find that the fencing posts are long enough to take a standard trellis, so I've made up my own here with this 25 by 38 millimetre, that's inch by inch and a half, roofing lath, which you can get from the builders' merchants. And I've included on it an extra leg just here so that it's quite easy to screw onto the fencing post. And that, of course, will soon be covered with climbers. And to get the climbers to grow up the fencing panels is really quite easy, because you just fix these horizontal wires to the posts with staples. But of course, the name of the game with climbers is fast growth. That's what you really want. But if you want that, you've got to lay the foundations in the first place. And this is the stuff to do it with: good, well-rotted farmyard manure. Now, the secret of success with any gardening is to get the soil fertile and then to keep it fertile. And if you can't get hold of farmyard manure, well, use spent mushroom compost in the first year, and from then on you can always supplement it with your own garden compost, of course. Now, you'll notice that I've put the manure in up the shoulder of the trench there, so that it will get to all levels of the soil rather than just putting it in the bottom of the trench. And then you simply throw the soil forward to form the next trench and carry on down the row like that. One of my favourite combinations of climbers are roses and clematis, because the rose can be trained up these horizontal wires to the top of the fencing panel, and then the clematis can be planted right alongside it. Bear in mind, these have to go in quite deeply, and that will use the branches of the rose as a framework to climb up to the top of the panel too. But do bear in mind that if you choose varieties that are going to be in flower at the same time, then you've got to be a little bit careful about your colour scheme.
Having hidden the walls and fences with colourful and scented climbers, we can create our own secret places using living things. For centuries, gardeners have used arbours as places to get away from their surroundings. Luckily, there are still young designers and builders around keeping this tradition alive. Claire Wilkes uses willow for her arbour.
So this is really very much like basket making, isn't it?
Yes, it is, as well as hurdle making, a mixture of the two.
Now you're using here a very bright yellow willow. What is that?
It's an alba, Salix alba, and specifically the Abascordiana. And just below it is the natural red.
Now the back of the seat there is really just like a willow hurdle, if you like, but the base of it here is actually living. Now how have you achieved that?
Well, this structure of weaving is dead, but through it I've planted all round the base living willow and then threaded it up through and taken it to the back. And then from the back it goes round outside and comes up the top, hoping that they'll get light from the back as well as from in here, because you can't guarantee that they'll all get a lot of sunlight because we're inside the arbour.
And when it does sprout, that means that you're going to have lots of shoots growing up here. Isn't it a bit uncomfortable to sit on?
Well, it depends if you've got stockings on or not, but it's basically little fine shoots, and it's quite fun to sit in the seat and weave them through, and people can't stop fidgeting when they're sitting in a living arbour.
I know that anything living like this really has a bit of a mind of its own, doesn't it? So how have you managed to keep this beautiful shape?
Well, because I've started by planting 15-foot willow wands in, these won't, in fact, change very much. But what will grow is the sprouts off them. So those ones that are planted there, I've twisted over into sort of a series of arches and then woven them round the back, so that there's diagonals which then help create the structure. The willow has all been coppiced a few times, so it's very long and straight, which helps it. It helps make a beautiful, perfect structure. If it was very branchy, I wouldn't be able to get that perfect curve shape.
For my arbour, I'm using hornbeam, which should be just the job. It looks very much like beech, and of course it's widely used for hedging, so it'll clip well, and it retains its brown leaves during the winter. Now, you could, of course, use beech equally well, and I must say that the winter colour is slightly better. But if your soil is a little bit on the poor side, or perhaps badly drained, hornbeam is much easier to grow. You'll have to search out a good tree nursery for plants like these, but they are certainly available. Now, I've marked out the circle, which is 1 metre in diameter, that's 6'6", and I've got space here for about 7 trees, something like 1 metre apart. So I'm planting where the pegs are. If the roots at the bottom of the plant are running round the pot, you'll need to just break them out a little bit. Otherwise, surprisingly, they continue to run round the pot, and that's not good for anchorage. Just firm the soil in a little bit with your heel as you go, but don't set them in concrete.
Each tree will now have to be supported with a short stake. I have to admit that they don't look very attractive, but they'll only be there for a year or two, because after that time the trees will set into the shape that you put them. Well, that's the easy part. The difficult bit is pulling the branches over to make arches like this. Now, like many landscape jobs, the only way of knowing that you've got this right is really by eye, so you might have to fiddle around quite a bit with it. And when you tie them together, don't for heaven's sake use wire in this case, because of course it'll cut into the bark and cure the tree. The same goes for any nylon twine. I use this plastic twist lock stuff, which is of course wider, and so it won't cut in. Though it is, I have to admit, a bit of a fiddle to fix. Then the next two can be pulled over into the middle in just the same way. They're tied on as well. The whole thing begins to take shape. Around the bottom of my arbour, I'm planting a circular lavender hedge so that when I sit in here, that delicious perfume will waft upwards, and of course it'll be full of bees and butterflies too. Now, the problem with lavender is that it does like a really well-drained soil, and that's the one thing my soil isn't. So I've worked in around here a whole load of coarse grit to improve the drainage, and they should really thrive on that. Now, it takes, what, 24 lavender to complete this circle, and that could be quite pricey. But in actual fact, I raised all these myself from seed. You don't need a greenhouse, they would go perfectly well outside. And I reckon that they cost me something like 10p each. And that's what I call a bargain. Finally, level the floor with a fork, cover it with bark chips, and your arbour will smell like a pine forest in spring. Millie, you've built a lovely, secluded little spot in your garden up here, surrounded by shrubs and shaded by this huge walnut tree. Do you use it very much?
Well, it was beautiful in the spring. We brought lots of people up to see the bluebells, cowslips, primroses. It was really lovely, and children loved to come up and run all up that garden and through that gap in the, well, it's a sort of hedge there, and they call it, well, we go through to the secret garden. They love that. We do have picnics. When the weather's really hot, it's always, you can always find cool nests up here. It's, in fact, sometimes it's so cool you have to move out into the sun to warm up again. But
you
I love
used to
the
actually
tree.
Bring to, stuff to lay down here, didn't
yes,
you?
Yes, yes. Yeah, we always loved getting right flat down, didn't we? It's a bit more of an effort to get up now, but we still do.
Yeah.
It's really relaxing. Lovely. And the tree is beautiful. I mean, the bark is fantastic, isn't it? I love it. It was lovely when we had the owls and with jackdaws about. We get hedgehogs up here, don't we? I see those rumbling around. I come up quite late sometimes just to see what there is around.
You get a few squirrels here too, don't you?
Yes, we don't welcome those very much, really. They really are rather a pest. They're lovely to see, aren't they? So acrobatic, but...
Horace, you had an unfortunate experience with a squirrel here once, didn't you?
Yes. We were lying down, taking it easy, you know, in a heat wave. And all of a sudden, it was a lovely blue sky like it is today. All of a sudden, there were some spots of moisture, whatever it was, coming down. So Millie got up and looked over the wall chap's garden next door, thinking he'd got a sprinkler on, and but no, there was nothing of that. So after a while we found out what it was. There was a squirrel straight up above us. And he was just weaned.
What I love about this place is the fact that you've got this lovely dappled light. That's beautiful. Mm, isn't it?
Beautiful. That's one thing about a walnut tree. It's never too dense, is it? You can always see the sky through it, and the sun always comes down through it. Mm. One of my friends said she hoped she wasn't being over fanciful, but she feels as if she's walking into a cathedral when she comes up here at sunset. The setting sun gives a sort of stained glass effect to the light through the walnut tree. And she's a very down-to-earth person, actually, so I was quite surprised.
There's something quite magical about the woodlands in the springtime. And, of course, it's countryside like this that has been the inspiration for our gardens. Over the centuries that man has been creating gardens, we've come to realise their value as peaceful, tranquil places for contemplation and reflection. Green was considered a colour which was particularly conducive to contemplation, reflection, prayer and study. It was also considered important to lift the spirits with the colour and perfume of flowers. So next week, I'll show how to design your garden for colour. Over the centuries that man has been creating gardens, we've come to realise their value as peaceful, tranquil places for contemplation and reflection. Even as far back as medieval times, we know that wealthy households would have had their pleasure gardens well insulated from the chaos outside, and religious orders their leafy places used to refresh the mind and soothe the spirit. Green was considered a colour which was particularly conducive to contemplation, reflection, prayer and study.
So every monastery would have had its area of plain grass, known as the cloister garth, which was used by the monks simply to concentrate their minds. But it was also considered important to lift the spirits with the colour and perfume of flowers. So some cultivated plants, but mostly wildflowers, would have been grown, often in grass, to surround the eye and assail the spirits with a feast of flowers.
In today's sometimes grey world, we need to add the beauty of colour more than ever. In this episode, I'll show you how we can draw from the past and fill our lives with pleasure by surrounding ourselves with the glorious colours of flowers. To begin with, we have to allow nature to seep into our bones, and we have to learn from the old country gardeners, who I'm quite sure had the right attitude. Of course, few of us would want the hardships that went with that simple old-fashioned country life that our grandparents knew. A leaky thatch, no running water or electricity, and trudging to work at first light in the snow and hail. But I firmly believe that our gardens, whatever their size, present us with the opportunity to have the best of that existence without the drawbacks. We can even go as far as to recreate those flowery meads so loved by the medieval monks. Miriam Rothschild's meadows demonstrate this on a grand scale.
I woke up suddenly one morning, looked at the fields, and not a flower in sight, and it suddenly struck me that modern agriculture just bulldozed and weed-killered and drained all the wildflowers out of the fields that I used to know when I was a child. We were living on a sort of snooker table, and I thought, well, this is terrible. We must do something about it, and that's what I started. Started trials to see if I could produce nothing more or less than a sort of medieval hayfield. Well, I started it by choosing a place here that would be, I thought, suitable, and not rich soil. There was rubble underneath the lawns here, and the rubble from the house, actually, when it was built. And I, that was used then for tennis courts and croquet lawns and bowling greens and so forth, about 3/4 acre. And I just let the grass grow there, scraped some bare patches, and sowed down seed, which I collected in the local derelict airfields. There's 96 species there, which is really very good. And the interesting part about that is very interesting, that quite a lot of rare plants have come in from the cold, which I haven't sown at all, but because the habitat's right, they've come in and settled there. I think the air must be full of those sort of seeds which settle and don't find a good place. For instance, the orchid seed, there are four different sorts of orchids that have come in on that field. That seed is so fine, it's like a lady's face powder. In fact, I think you're breathing orchids all the time here. But it's they're floating about and they settle. They don't find the symbiotic bacteria that they need to germinate. And the soil's no good. Down there on the tennis court, they've obviously found the right thing. Years, two or three years after you've sowed, one plant very often comes to dominate and for a short time just takes over the field, and the field at the Slade's been taken over by a marvellous crop of oxeye daisies and red clover. It looks very, very pretty, but it'll even out after probably next year. There'll be much fewer oxeye daisies, and then slowly it'll get like an ordinary field where you have them dotted here and there. Anyone can grow it, providing they've follow certain rules. I mean, your soil has got to be more or less the right sort of soil. I mean, it's no good having frightfully acid sand or something like that. It's got to be sort of meadow, what you would have a hay meadow in. It's no good scattering it by hand. You've got to drill it in. I've tried to grow it by all sorts of methods. Different sorts of harrowings, different sorts of drilling, hand scat, everything you think of to see. And I've come down to the view that it's better to drill it in if it's a big meadow. If it's a small one, like a tennis court, you can do it by hand.
Well, the medieval flowery mead, Francesca, is something which is actually coming back into fashion now. But what's its history?
Well, it's the earliest form of medieval garden. There had been a flowery mead outside the Norman castle or fortified dwelling. And what it was an area of long grass with wildflowers growing up into it. And that's what I've got here.
Now, all around it, you've cut paths as well.
That's right, yes.
Is this something they would have done in medieval times?
Yes, indeed. They would have had paths in between the long grass so people could walk and obviously not crush the flowers. And they would have cut it with scythes, so it wouldn't be quite so short as it is now, or just squashed the grass down, just trodden it down to make the paths around the long grass areas.
Well, of course, this is something which conservationists are urging us to do now.
Oh, yes, that's right. Yes. And it's quite easily done, in a way. I mean, with this one, I just put perennial wildflowers in it, and the campion is looking wonderful, and the oxeye daisy as well. And that works quite well.
And did you actually plant the plants or do it from seed?
I grew them from seed and get them into pots with nice big roots, and then I plant them in. Annual wildflowers wouldn't really compete with the very strong grass that grows here.
But you must cut the grass.
Yes, I cut it twice a year. Not with a scythe, I hasten to add. I do it with a medieval strimmer. And I cut it in the spring to about 6 inches and rake all the cuttings off. And then I do it again in the autumn when all the plants have finished. And that's all I have to do with it, really.
The medieval flowering mead was an inspiring idea, but it has to be said that it did have its limitations, particularly for modern small gardens. So I want to use that inspiration, but bring it up to date to make a little bit more interest for small spaces. Now, the flowers in the medieval mead grew through a green sward of grass, and that's the place to start. But we could use ornamental grasses to blend a tapestry of colour. I'd certainly start with this one, Festuca glauca, which has superb steely blue foliage. And that would make a very good contrast with this Carex Evergold. There are plenty of different colours of Carex, and just look at this one with its buff leaves with a green background. I think that one looks superb. Or you could use the variegated Melinia, which produces these lovely flowering shoots too. Now, all these plants require very little maintenance, just a shear over in the spring. Another one that I love is Bowles Golden Grass. Now, this one doesn't look much in the winter, admittedly, but it has the attractive habit of seeding all over the place. So in the spring, it'll come up in amongst all the other plants and look really wonderful. Now, instead of using wildflowers to grow through the grasses, we could use all kinds of herbaceous perennials to add a lot more interest. They should again be planted in large drifts, and of course this means that you want a lot of plants of the same variety. And that makes them absolutely ideal for raising quite cheaply from seed. And I've raised all this lot from just a few packets of seeds. You just start them off on the windowsill and then grow them on in a cold frame. You need no specialised equipment. And I've got here, well, little dwarf chrysanthemums. There are orange poppies here. Evening primroses should look good. And there are a whole variety of veronicas in different colours there. Penstemons too are very easy to grow. And I've even raised a few strawberries so that I can do just what the medieval monks would have done and wander through my flowery mead picking the odd wild strawberry. Wonderful. Before you start planting, it's not a bad idea to set the plants out in their pots first so that you can see where you're going. Start off with the lower growing plants, like the grasses, and put them out in large drifts. But remember to leave enough space for them to spread and to plant taller growing plants in between. By midsummer, my cultivated flowery mead is looking just as it should. And of course, later on, many of these plants, and some of the grasses too, will seed themselves around and come up again next year. Now, there's very little work to do at the moment because the plants are so close together that very few weeds have the chance to get in. I shall leave the meadow exactly as it is for the winter to give a few seeds for the birds and, of course, to allow the plants to seed themselves around properly. And then in the very early spring, I shall cut over the whole lot, either with a pair of shears or even with a strimmer, and they'll all come back the following year stronger than ever. Those latter-day gardeners who surrounded themselves with their flowery meads, their shady trees and their cool areas of plain grass were quite consciously aiming to produce an earthly paradise. Their vision of the delights they could expect later in heaven created here on Earth. And for my money, they were not far wrong. If there was some way that I could choose my own eternal paradise, this would be it. An English garden in summer, filled with the soothing colour of flowers, heady with the perfume of roses, and alive with the buzzing of insects and the chatter of birds. We're in Hampshire, at the home of Rosamond Wallinger. Ros, we gardeners are pretty fortunate, aren't we?
I'm especially lucky, because about 12 years ago we bought a house that was very run down with a derelict garden. And with enthusiastic help and inspiration from friends who knew better, I started to restore it. And 12 years on, it's a really satisfying garden. It's a pretty garden.
Terrific to create a thing like that, isn't it? Tell me, when you come out here on a beautiful summer's morning and you just take a stroll around your lovely garden, what do you feel and what do you think?
Oh, it feels like taking in a big breath of happiness and not letting it out. You go around realising that nature is completely satisfying and fulfilling and gentle and right. And I just feel completely happy. And then when I get into the grumps or the something, you can dig and get rid of the weeds, or it's just complete enjoyment, start to finish really, except when the weather changes.
Well, of course, garden design has now moved on quite a lot from the flowery meads and the indiscriminate planting of cottage gardens to something a lot more stylized. Now, why do you think that that became popular?
I think because last century, an amazing woman, Gertrude Jekyll, started to develop gardening as an art form, because she'd studied art and architecture and she was trying to translate this into her use of plants. And she called her gardening painting the landscape with living things. She made it an art. And I think that through her books, the world then learnt the art of gardening.
And why did you want to plant a Gertrude Jekyll garden?
Well, we were lucky enough to buy a house whose garden had original Jekyll plans. We didn't realise it when we were buying it, but when we got round to actually signing the contract and we found that we could get copies of the plans and that very few other people in the world could do that. It was the challenge of being able to do something very few other people could do. I could get almost every plant that Jekyll had designed for this garden in 1908, and there didn't seem any point in putting anything other than Jekyll in. I'd never gardened before and I couldn't improve on her, so I just followed the plans.
Now, Jekyll had a particular system of planting, didn't she?
Yes, in her main herbaceous borders, she was very particular about how she used colour and how she moved colour in drifts from one end of the border to the other. And very often she'd start with cool colours at either end, running to hot colours in the centre. Hot colours are red, yellow, orange, very stimulating, and the cool colours at either end are the purples and the whites and the blues and the greens. And it's rather like looking into the distance. The horizon always looks grey, purpley and cool. And it gave a much better perspective if you look through a hot colour to a cool colour, much longer perspective.
So would it actually make your garden look bigger?
It can, it should. You try it yourself with your tomato ketchup near you and something yellow in the distance or white, and the distance is far longer than if you reverse it.
A good point for a small garden. People like you and me, who tend to draw some inspiration from the past, are often these days accused of living in the past. What do you have to say to that?
Gardening, like all art, moves on. But it doesn't mean to say that because Jekyll was 1900, that it's no longer art any more than because Titian was centuries ago, it's no longer art. It's something you learn from. I get the most overwhelming sense of happiness. I suppose it's the same thing. And I'm not looking at it as my child. I'm looking at it as hers, as a custodian, so that makes it better. Every year since I started, it's got more and more beautiful, and every year I thought, can't get better. And it does. It's wonderful. And the older the garden gets and the slightly wiser I get, the more I love it. So we sort of develop together. It redevelops, and I'm learning as I go. And the more I look at it, season by season, the more I love it.
Well, with Rosamund's garden as an example, I'm also going to colour theme my borders. But with the one difference, that the garden here is divided into four quarters. So each of these quarters is going to have its own colour theme. Now, in this one, I'm going to put all the dark purples and the dark reds, perhaps lightened here and there with a little bit of white. Now, over this side, I'm going to plant all the soft blues and the pinks. They'll go very well together and they'll make a very soothing scene. Now, over this side, because it's so close to the patio, I'm going to plant all perfumed plants. Now, I've already started off with some roses, and now I'm going to put in this lovely scented honeysuckle, Lonicera perfusii. By midsummer, it's possible to see how effective this planting scheme is. This is the purple and the red border, with the colour coming from the flowers of things like the lovely long-flowering herbaceous geraniums, the crane's bills, the alliums, which are just about going out of flower now, but have been going for a long time. The irises, when they've finished flowering, their spiky foliage will form a really good contrast with the other foliage around. And of course, the roses, which come in a whole range of deep reds and purples. Towards the edge of the border, the plants become lighter red and deep pink, so that they'll merge with the pink and blue border across the path. I've used crane's bills here too, both pink and blue varieties. And how about these superb foxgloves right at the back in apricot pink? But we all have our disasters, I'm afraid, and these yellow irises are mine. When I bought those, they were not in flower, of course, and they were sold to me as blue. Well, I'm not going to move them until they've gone out of flower, but as soon as they do, they can be shifted over here into the yellow border. And this border is really bright, bordering on the gaudy, I suppose, with bright yellow flowers from hardy perennials like the achillea. And the Eureops behind it is on the tender side, but very easy to keep over the winter. That's backed by the brilliant yellow foliage of the golden elder, which should be pruned quite hard in the springtime. And then that contrasts very well with the spiky foliage of the yellow-edged phormium here. Well, the planting still isn't quite finished, but it's enough, I think, to see how satisfactory is the overall effect. Yes, I have drawn unashamedly from the past, but I've used more modern, longer flowering varieties of the same plants that Gertrude Jeker would have used. And certainly it soothes my eye, it lifts my spirit, and it fills my heart with joy. And that makes it a work of art. I think that these pots nicely finish off my very soothing borders. And you know, sitting here surrounded by water is really very restful indeed. Well, next week we'll be looking at all kinds of different water features and showing you how to build them. There are a few things that give me such a sense of well-being as sitting in the quiet of the countryside beside a natural pond. There's a great sense of peace and tranquility here, and if you sit really quiet and still, you're bound to see birds coming down to drink, the odd dragonfly flitting around, and of course, a thousand insects. Still or gently running water with all the broken reflections of the trees and the sky, and of course a million miles from the hustle and bustle of so-called civilization, somehow concentrates the mind on all that is natural and good about the simple life. So it's little wonder that those first gardeners put such an emphasis on the importance of water in their gardens.
The Middle East was the setting for the earliest water gardens. Later, in the 4th century BC in Greece, there were gardens dedicated to the gods, and these influenced gardening in Rome, which must have had a profound and long-lasting effect on European garden design. What all these gardens had in common was that they existed in hot countries, where water and shade were essential. But they were also highly valued for their relaxing qualities. Our hectic lifestyle today means that water can work in exactly the same way in our gardens. Alas, country ponds are few and far between, and access is often denied. All the more reason, then, to transport that idyllic country dew pond to our own garden, or to travel further abroad and bring back the canals and fountains of the ancient East and install them in our own backyards. Certainly, we'll have to reduce the scale and grandeur to suit a somewhat more humble setting, but they will have exactly the same effect on our senses as they did on those Moorish designers all those years ago. At Barnsdale, I'll build two very different water features. In the town garden, one that's rather expensive. In the budget garden, I'll simply aim to reproduce a small country pond, which will cost very little.
A pool can be as big or as small as you like, but make it as deep as you can. Because the deeper it is, the cooler the water will stay, and that will help to keep it clear. And it's also important to make the top of the pond level, because quite obviously the water is going to stay level, and you don't want acres of liner showing above the water level in certain places. So put a few pegs in all around the pond, level those in with a spirit level, and then level the soil to the pegs. And then after that, you can bash the pegs down. It's easy to see that the soil here is very stony indeed, and those sharp stones would very quickly cut through the liner. So it's essential to protect it first. From the water garden supplier, you can buy a special fibre liner like this. And it's very efficient and very simple to use. You just lay it out, put a few bricks on it, and roll it out to cover every inch of the soil inside the pond. The rubber liner, of course, has to be all in one piece. So it's a little bit more of a fiddle to put down, and quite a bit heavier too. But it's done in exactly the same way. Just put it down, put a few bricks on top of the end of it, and roll it out. Pond is much more natural and acceptable to wildlife if the liner is covered with soil. But this is not my own stony old stuff. This is a bit of soil I've bought in specially, which is more or less stone free and nice and soft. And when I put the soil in, I should be able to create some nice gentle contours in the pond, so that wildlife, if it falls in accidentally, can get out again. Hedgehogs are notorious for blundering into ponds and having to scrabble their way out. Of course, the exciting job for us kids is filling it up with water. It will look very muddy to start with, but don't worry, it'll soon settle down and clear. Paul, your collection of ponds here are looking absolutely wonderful. Why did you choose to have an informal, natural-looking pond?
Because it attracts more wildlife, that's the basic reason. You know, I hate to see, you know, a formal pond's okay and it's in the right place, but I like it to look as natural as possible because it attracts more wildlife. There's places for them to hide. I hate to see it looking too actual tidy and trimmed up. It just looks more natural with the flowers when they're grown through the long grass.
Now, the whole system starts with this little tiny pond up at the top. What's the idea of that?
Purely somewhere for the tadpoles to breed in peace from the fish and to also top up the main system with fresh water.
And does the tadpole breeding centre really work?
Oh, it does. There's nothing to see sort of 200 adults in the spring, and you've just got to be careful where you put your feet on a damp night. Yes.
That's quite amazing, isn't it? But in this pond, you've got quite a lot of large fish. Now, what are they?
The main fish are koi, but there are mirror carp, tench, which are bottom feeders, and some rudd.
And then the system comes down here through a series of streams and pipes and works its way right the way around the house to the bottom.
Well, basically, we've got a garden on this gentle slope. It's pumped from the lowest point to the highest point. It passes down through a stream which goes through weed that filters the silt out of it into a tank at the bottom end of the stream on the opposite side of the garden. Then it goes piped down to the back pond, down a 12-foot drop, into tanks, and then pumped all the way round and filtered on the way.
This is a wonderful pond here. What's this here?
That's a Viburnum mariscii. It gives a lovely show in the spring. But I say it's well worth the mess that you get in the autumn.
I love the way it just hangs over the pond. And then you've got all this lovely planting around the side. What are these?
Yes, Dactylizer, an orchid from the Mediterranean region. It benefits from the dampness and looks so nice.
It's a lovely thing, isn't it?
We've got Iris siberica, Iris levigata, the green-leafed and variegated. There's also cowslips, which benefit from being out in the full sunlight, plus moisture at the roots. Water lilies, elodea, the Canadian pomweed.
Lovely. Paul, you seem to be very keen on the lovely skunk cabbage. You've got lots of them planted throughout the pond. How did they come there?
I planted the original large plants, but in the last 3 or 4 years, they've gradually worked their way down through the stream. They've seeded into the banks, into the waterfalls.
So the answer then really is to plant those sort of plants at the top of the system, upstream, as it were, so that they'll float downwards.
That's right, as they would in the wild. Yeah. Which makes it so natural.
What do you get out of your water garden?
Just to see everything doing so well. When it's quiet and you've just got the sound of the last little birds singing, you hear the water trickling down through, the fish are still moving, hunting for insects. It's just, you know, it just calms you down, you know, after a sort of a reasonably hectic day.
If you have a friend who has a pond, it's quite likely that he'll be very keen to help you out with plants because aquatic plants all grow very fast and so they need cleaning out from time to time. Now, this is the most important plant of all. It's a variety of Canadian pondweed, and this is the stuff that will provide the oxygen underneath the water. And that's good news for all the animals under there, and also, of course, it'll keep the water clean. Now, other marginal plants, like these bulrushes, can just be pulled out at this time of the year. And it's bound to have some roots, and with this one you can see that it's also got a nice new little plant on there, so that'll give you two good plants. As long as you keep the plants in the bucket of water, they'll last for several days, so there's no real need to plant them straight away. But the water in the pond has inevitably gone quite green, so we need to pump some oxygen into it with these plants, and it really is quite simple to do. You simply get a bunch together and take cuttings, really, using the ends of the plants, and you tie a bit of string around the bottom, and the idea is to tie a stone around the bottom of the clump like this, and then throw it in the pond, and that'll root in the mud in the bottom. Planting the marginal plants is even easier. The first thing to do is just to cut them back a bit to stop them flopping over in the wind. And then you need to know the sort of depth that they like to be below the water. So check that in the book first. And then just simply push the roots into the mud at the bottom, like that, and that's planted. Around the edges of the pond, it's a bit of a different matter. In nature, there will be a boggy area there with suitable plants growing in it. And that's the way I want this to look. But of course, I've got a liner in my pond, so although there's water in the pond, the soil around the edges is quite dry. So the first thing to do is to make sure that the soil is well prepared with a lot of manure or compost, and then to choose plants that will grow in boggy areas but will also do well in dry soil. Things like this Lysimachia are ideal, and the irises are good too. So then it's just a case of planting in the normal way. And when this is finished, the pond will look just like the one in the countryside. Just 9 months later, the plants have grown up to hide the edges, the water has become crystal clear, and it's being visited by all kinds of wildlife. It has now become, for all the world, like a little country dew pond.
Apart from the plains, you tend to notice that, well, the water is a big feature in the garden. That's really nice to listen to when we turn the pump on.
Well, I wanted it to be more than just a pond. I wanted it to be quite a striking water feature. I thought something sculptural up against the water would be quite useful, and to create a bit of height in the garden, something vertical made sense to reflect the shape of the pool. So that's when I got in touch with Johnny, who does all the sculpture. And came up with an idea of maybe using something that was like a monolith shape from the film 2001, and really let him take over from there.
Yeah, so using a very simple form, a simple, very straightforward rectangle, and three gourd shapes to hold the plants and have a passage of water through them. A very slow passage dripping here, and the more rapid passage down below. There are two feeds, one that travels behind the copper monolith, obviously the slower feed, which you can see dripping, and then there is a more rapid feed that can be variable to the bottom.
Because we also wanted to try and increase the space in the garden, or the illusion of having more space, we decided to take it right across the garden from one fence to the other. And we have the only way to get to the other side is via a stepping stone. And it immediately made the garden look a lot bigger. We also wanted to have, because we seem to already have a lot of frogs in the garden, we knew we'd get tadpoles, but we wanted the tadpoles to have a safe place to swim into. And the granite sets, which have water in between, is a naturally safe haven for them to hide from any marauding fish. I've always liked the work of a Mexican architect called Louis Barragan, and he uses a lot of granite sets near to water, and it just made sense to develop it a little bit, and having the water in between the joints make them look like they're floating. Because we're in a townhouse, we're looking down on the garden all the time. You can actually see it very well from upstairs. In fact, the whole garden looks great from upstairs. Water is a very primitive natural element, so it always holds a fascination from when you're a kid right up to when you're quite old.
Now, Jeff, you live in the middle of the town, and yet you seem to live a very quiet, tranquil life here. I'm sitting in your garden room, and all I can hear is the sound of a little fountain out there. Now, that's a pebble fountain, isn't it? How did you actually build that?
Well, underneath the pebbles, there's a fairly large bowl, something like a big washing-up bowl, that holds 5 gallons of water. And across the bowl is a sort of grid, a metal grid, on which the pebbles are actually sort of sitting. I've allowed a space at the back for putting in these plants, which I change from time to time. If they start looking a bit weary, I've got other plants that I can sort of...
Oh, they're all in pots?
At the back. They're in pots, yes.
And a little pump that drives the water around.
Yes, a little pump, a little electric pump sitting in the bowl.
Now the lizard is delightful. Where on earth do you buy things like that?
Well, my daughter made that. It was the very first sort of wartime that she made. And she'd gone on to make a whole series of them since. Snakes,
really?
Lizards.
That's beautiful, isn't it? Yeah. Now, you say that you asked your daughter to design you a lizard. Why a lizard?
I did some work in Africa, in Nigeria, sort of a few years ago. And whilst I was there, I noticed these lizards sort of scaling the walls in very much the same sort of way that this is doing. In fact, they actually got in the sort of hotel rooms. Perhaps that was in my mind when I asked her to make me a lizard.
It looks great, I think. The only thing that strikes me
is that you've fixed it in a somewhat Heath Robinson way, if I might say.
Yes, I mean, since then, she has actually sort of made fixing holes in the corners.
Yeah.
That very first that very first effort didn't include that feature. And so I've just had to sort of prop it in with those...
Trouds.
Yeah.
I quite like them, actually.
You oh, well, yes. Oh, yes. I shall have to.
My second pond is the more expensive of the two. It features running water, which involves a runnel, a canal, pumps and pipes.
The pond in the town garden is made in very much the same way as the smaller one, except that here, instead of using the fibre liner, I've used builder's sand, which is a very good alternative. I've also had to put up a bit of wooden shuttering with concrete behind as a foundation for the summer house, and there's a little bit of walling there as well. There's a concrete base too underneath the runnel. Now, the liner will go on top of that base before the bricks are put on, and then it can be brought up behind the back of the bricks where it won't be seen. At the halfway stage of building the pond and the runnel, it's easy to see how it's made. First of all, we built a special brick pier to take the lion's head. And behind the brickwork, there's a piece of plastic pipe that goes through into the mouth of the lion at the back, and it carries the water that is pumped from the pond. It goes into the runnel, which is made with these bricks set on end. These little half circles are designed to take pots of irises. But the thing to note is that the bricks are built on top of the liner, and that means that you can bring it up behind the back of the bricks, hold it there with a bit of soil, and provided it's above the water level, then of course the runnel can't leak. Now, liners have to be in one piece, and if you were going to have one liner here for both the pond and the runnel, it would have to be enormous. It would have to cover more or less the whole garden, and that would be very expensive and there would be a lot of waste. But in this particular case, you can have two pieces of liner, provided the one for the runnel actually overlaps the pond liner. And then the water's only got one place to go, that's into the pond, and it can't leak. To circulate the water, you need a small submersible pump. Now, this actually goes into the water. It's a good idea to have a word with the supplier, who will be able to advise you about the size of pump that you need. And of course, this is run by electricity. And you must bear in mind that because this is in the garden, it's potentially dangerous. So it's much better to get a qualified electrician to do it rather than trying it yourself. And you must use waterproof plugs and waterproof sockets too. Now, the water is circulated through a plastic pipe, and on the end of it there's this little gizmo which regulates the amount of water that the pump will push through. And that simply fixes onto the top of the pump like that, nice and firm, and then the whole thing drops into the water. Now, the pipe goes up over the edge of the pond, underneath the soil, through the back of the brick pier and out through the lion's mouth. And now for the acid test. Let's see if it works.
pond attracts lots of wildlife. And I'm fascinated to sit here in the very early morning or late afternoon, just watching as they go about their daily chores. Next week, I'll be showing how you can immerse yourself in the natural world and how you can surround yourself with perfume too.
For me, one of the great joys of this series has been the inspiration to my imagination and making those ideas come to life in my own gardens.
Should look really great. Well, my two private paradises are now complete. And as I look round this garden, I hope it doesn't sound too conceited if I say that with a great deal of help from nature, I know that I have created a work of art. Now, I know that because looking round this garden fills my heart with joy. And if you can do that, it doesn't matter what anybody else thinks, you have made a work of art. And of course, everybody can do it, because if you're kind to her, then dear old Mother Nature will give you a big helping hand along the way. But there are some things about this garden that you can't see, and I suppose the most important is that as I walk through this gate, my nose is assaulted by a wonderful variety of perfume. Now, of course, that's great for the gardener, but bear in mind that that perfume was really designed to attract pollinating insects. And that means that if you fill your garden with perfume, you'll also fill it with bees and butterflies. Well, Diana, you've designed a garden here specifically for wildlife. What made you do it?
Well, ever since I've been very young, I've always been interested in all aspects of wildlife, and I can't think of anything better than to be able to look at it in your own garden.
Do you also think it's important to provide alternative habitats for wildlife?
Yes, I think it is, because if you're having a garden such as mine where no chemicals are used, there's a place for wildlife to be able to come to. The increase of pesticides, etc., is actually wiping out wildlife. Mm.
So is this something which is restricted to the countryside, or could you do it in the town?
No, No, I mean, if you create the right sort of environment, there's no reason, even in the inner city, why you can't attract all sorts of different wildlife to your garden. Well, I think there are basic principles to observe. The first, I think, is that you've got to start from the lowest life forms and then build your way up. If you start off by introducing flowering plants, immediately you begin to attract insects. Once you have the flowering plants and the insects, you want to attract birds. And birds will be quite happy to come after the insects and also after the seeds, but they need somewhere to perch. So you then need to have some tall shrubs and some ornamental trees for them to feel as if they are in a safe environment.
Now, looking around, you're obviously a plantaholic because you've made the borders bigger. Is providing that sort of cover also important for wildlife?
Yes, because I think that if you have, as was here when we first came, the garden was just an open expanse. There was very little wildlife coming into the garden at all. And I think if you can create lots of cover, then gradually the wildlife will feel more secure into coming into the garden.
So what sort of cover have you got? I notice over there you've got a big mound.
Yes, well that's covered with lots of ground cover there. And there's habitat obviously in there for slugs and snails, and we also have a very large ant's nest in there. But slugs and snails are even important in a garden because frogs obviously like to come and collect slugs, so do hedgehogs. You have to have a combination of everything to get the balance of nature just right.
What can I do if I want, say, to attract butterflies?
Well, butterflies love scented plants, so by introducing a lot of scented plants around the garden, that will bring butterflies in. And there are obvious things such as sedums and Michaelmas daisies and buddleias, which are always a great attraction for butterflies. There are things like the opium poppies, which are good for all sorts of bees and hoverflies. Things like the foxgloves, which attract insects. There are a lot of flowering plants. Also, there are native plants as well that you could use, such as meadowsweet, which we actually grow around the pond. The most important thing you can do to encourage wildlife in the garden is to introduce water. And for preference, a still pond. That begins immediately to start attracting newts and frogs. They seem to smell it within days of you putting it in. But if you're lucky, you'll also get hedgehogs or badgers or even foxes coming to drink from the pond, dragonflies, damselflies. You get a mass of life with a pond.
Just outside your garden, on the verges, I noticed that you've got lots of stinging nettles.
Yes, yes.
The council don't cut that verge, obviously, and you keep the stinging nettles. Why is that?
Well, that verge does belong to the council rather than to us, and there are nettles there, which obviously are the foodstuff of some insects, caterpillars of certain butterflies. I'd rather have nettles outside in the verge than I would have them growing in the garden. Mm.
So, do you think it would be a good thing if we tried to stop councils cutting verges too much?
Yes, I do. Mm.
It seems to me that with a little more thought and imagination, road verges and hedges all over the country could be left to become havens for wildlife. As I continued my search for more paradise gardens, I remembered Miriam Rothschild's grand wildflower meadows and her even grander plan for the highways and byways of Britain.
After I'd been sort of reintroducing flowering hayfields all over the place for 20 years, I suddenly thought, well, I'm going off the ground into the hedgerows now. It was rather amusing. And I began to think of all the things which one used to see flowering hedgerows, wild roses among them. To my new hedges, I introduced wild roses. And up on part of the old airfield, I've got really a wonderful show there, I must admit it. And there are 9 species. and you can have your hedges as if they had ice cream all over them. I mean, wonderful white flowers the whole way around. I'd like to see the whole country full of wild roses, and you could plant them along all the hedgerows on the main roads, the big bypasses and on the big A1s and M2s and 3s. The whole way along there you could have the wild roses. It's perfectly easy to propagate wild roses. I mean, you can take cuttings off a bush, hundreds of them. There's a new way now of growing these wild rose cuttings in water, you know, and you can get thousands of them going quite easily with very little labour. I think it could be advertised. I think you would see, it's very funny, you know, people have the thoughts at the back of their minds for years before they sort of come out into the open. But once the idea's there, it could very easily be roused. I think you could soon get flowering hedgerows along our motorways. And I have written about that too, about putting in wildflowers along the road. And I think there'd be wonderful nectar lanes for butterflies. You'd have a lot of butterflies along there. And you know, in the States, in Texas, along the road verges there, which are much wider than ours, they give large, very large, wide road verges. You get even hummingbirds there. They come to the flowers along. I've seen hummingbirds along road verges in Texas. You get a lot of wild flowers and a lot of marvellous birds.
What a dream, eh? To cover the whole country with the summer colour and the heady perfume of roses. And you know, if enough of us want it, well, sometimes those dreams have a habit of coming true. In the meantime, we can all create our own little bit of earthly paradise by filling our gardens with the perfumes of the countryside. But when I visited the Cottage Herbary in Worcestershire, I discovered that Kim Hurst didn't really have to try too hard. Kim, you're living here in an absolutely idyllic spot, surrounded by trees and fields, perfectly quiet, even a little babbling brook at the end of the garden. If this isn't paradise, I don't know what is. But it's a bit isolated, isn't it?
Well, yes and no. It's not too far from the main road, but that's the way I like it. I like to have the peace and quiet and be able to hear all the noises of the countryside and the birds and everything.
Now, you're a great gardener, of course, Kim, and you're surrounded here by colour. But how important do you think perfume is in the garden?
Very important, especially in a south-facing garden like this. We've got lots of things like honeysuckles and philadelphus, a lot of the aromatic type shrubs as well, and they're really important in the garden.
Thank you. You grow quite a lot of old roses too, don't you?
Yes, I do, yes.
Are there any there that you could really recommend for perfume?
Things like William Lobb and Cardinal de Richelieu. There's also things like Gertrude G called the Climbing Rose.
I know you sell herbs for culinary purposes and perhaps medicinal purposes too, but they're also important for perfume as well, aren't they?
Yes, very much so, yeah. Things like the artemisias, you can use those a lot. You've got a good, sort of strong aromatic plant there. Then there's all the mints, lemon mint, ginger mint, eau de cologne, that's a particularly good one to use. Very strong aromatic plant.
Because you're a herb specialist, you're obviously growing your plants in special herb gardens, but they do go well on the border too, don't they?
Oh yes, you mix them very well in the border. Things like the bronze fennel and the green fennel always look really nice in a border because you've got that lovely feathery foliage. Things like Calamintha grandiflora, that really is a special plant that needs to be at the front of the border, and you've got the scent and the flares of that. And things like feverfew looks nice dotted around in the garden too, the little white daisy flowers.
Well, you've also got a small family apart from your husband, Rob. You've got a young daughter, India.
Yes.
Do you not think it's be better for her in the town?
Oh, no, 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 no way. She loves it here. In fact, she said, you will leave it to me, won't you, Mum? And I can stay here forever. You know, she really does love it here, and she says it's the best place on earth, which is really great from a child of seven to say that.
Patricia Siddle has created a brightly coloured paradise in Cheshire, bathed in perfume. Being visually impaired means she has very little choice, even though her original plans were more subtle.
Well, Pat, it's mid-July and your garden is looking very beautiful, but you didn't actually plant it for what it looks like, did you?
No. Initially I did, but later on I designed it and planted it mainly for scent and sociability.
So why did you plant it for scent?
Because although I was always aware of perfume, it wasn't the predominant thing in the garden. But when my eyesight began to fail about 4 years ago, obviously it became more important, because not only do I want to work in the garden, which I do, I like to sit in it. I really like to enjoy it. And that, to me, there is nothing nicer on a nice day than just sitting here and smelling all the smells around me and waiting for the wind to change direction, and then I get a smell of something else. And it's just my idea of bliss.
When you've planted your garden, do you look for plants that have a very sensitive, subtle smell, or the better perfumed plants?
Well, it has been known to say that my aspirations were for certain seating areas to smell like a Tarte's boudoir.
How do you know what a Tarte's boudoir smells like?
Well, I can dream about it. I think it would smell something like this. There's lovely, heavy, musky scents.
So, OK, so when you buy plants then, you must have to research very carefully about the sort of perfume that you've got.
I don't research it, I buy them in flower, because I've been disappointed with quite a number of plants that I've researched and found out about that's reputed to have had this wonderful perfume. But when I get them, I can't smell anything. So now I wait till they're actually out and then go and smell them, and that's how I buy them. Because I garden on my hands and knees, I don't miss out on the scents. But, and I'm also learning now to actually put plants higher. A lot of people actually appreciate something that's maybe subtly scented to be raised a bit higher. So I'm beginning to think about ways that I can arrange that.
I've also noticed, Pat, as I've walked through, some plants that are good to touch.
Yes. I'm a bit childish, really. I quite like touching them. There's this lamb's ear, for example. Every time I go past that, I give it a little squeeze.
Lovely furry leaves, aren't they?
Beautiful. Yeah. And while we're on the subject of touch, I've found to my disadvantage is that when I'm trying to prune or train the climbing roses, I can get prickled because I can't actually see where the thorns are. So I've been looking around and found this one, which is a beautiful old-fashioned...
Zephyrin Druin.
That's the very one. And I haven't got the problem of thorns, but I've still got the old-fashioned scent, so that's the best of both worlds.
Beautiful, isn't it? Pat, do you actually do all the gardening yourself?
Oh, yes. I actually designed this one from scratch, and I did it on graph paper before my eyesight went, with the intention of creating different corners and different rooms. With the option to develop the corners differently if I felt so inclined as I went along.
Oh, now, this is the compost area in here, isn't
yes.
it? And amazingly, you've even got scented plants here as well.
Well, why not? I spend a lot of time in here, coming up and down in the garden, and I like something to smell nice.
Well, this is the pineapple broom, and oh, it smells beautiful, doesn't it?
Yeah,
pure
it does.
Pineapples. Really lovely.
I think since I've been gardening, I've learned and appreciated more about nature and how clever nature is. She does some wonderful things for me. She's very generous, because if I've been cutting the wrong things off and whatever, it all bounces up again. All the freebies I get with seeds. All the mistakes you make, somehow, give a week or two, and they seem to pale into insignificance with the rest of the garden. And it makes you feel quite humble, really, that you can make all these painstaking efforts with all these thoughts, and you just turn around and it's just done it itself. Special. This is my favourite bit in the day. This is the Patricia Arms.
I met a man living in a remote cottage that you enter through a hole in the wall, who has gardened for 82 years. Herbert Exton is 90 now, and his garden proves perfect testimony to his knowledge. Many of the gardeners in this series have made their creations of paradise seem really easy, but believe me, What they have achieved is remarkable and has delighted me. One of the great things about gardening is that we all learn from each other.
Well, Herbert, you've got a fantastic garden. How long have you been here?
About 41 years now. Well, a friend told me about this place and we came to see it. It was absolutely derelict, but I could see, you know, that it had potential, so we took it, and everybody thought I was mad for doing it. Yeah. And there was nothing in the garden at all. It was just a sea of docks, nettles and elderberry bushes and laurels and thousands of milk bottles and everything by the kitchen sink. I've got over 2,000 varieties of plants in the garden here. It's years ago when I, well, some years since I counted them up, and I shouldn't like to start now. I'll just spend about, 3 hours in the morning and perhaps 3 hours in the afternoon. I have a job getting up and down, I can get down, or obviously I'm well getting up. I'm floundering about like a baby elephant sometimes. The biggest trouble I had was with pheasants. I had about 1,000 crocuses around the edge of this lawn and about 1,000 tulips, and the pheasants cleaned the lot up, dug them all up. The trouble is they can run faster than I can, so I can't catch them. This is what I call a misplaced sundial. It doesn't tell any happy hours. I'll still have to move it out into the sun one of these fine days. Oh, it's beautiful. It's just peace. Just peace it is. I'm not religious with regard to coming to church, but I says this is my church up here, in the garden. I don't own it, I only rent it. I rent it from, he's a farmer, he owns all this land around here. I feel now I've been a fool doing it, but at the same time, years ago, I mean, damn days I couldn't afford it to have bought anything. I couldn't have bought a rabbit hutch even. I've had my pleasure out of it, and that's the chief thing.
In the city with the hustle and bustle of people and the noise and pollution of traffic, or on a crowded housing estate overlooked on all sides by your neighbours. Or if, like me, you live in the countryside and have to cope with the bucolic pleasures like the rattle of the combine harvester and the roar of the jet plane, you can still use your garden to create your own personal private paradise that will put a song in your heart and fill every day of your life with joy. Make sure you don't miss out.